Mira, mira, they're setting up for tonight. The music competition for Dia de Muertos. You want to be like your hero? You should sign up.
My family would freak.
Look, if you're too scared, then, well, have fun making shoes. Come on, what did De La Cruz always say?
Seize your moment.
Show me what you got, muchacho. I'll be your first audience.
Miguel!
Abuelita!
What are you doing here? You leave my grandson alone.
Doña, please. I was just getting a shine.
I know your tricks, mariachi. What did he say to you?
He was just showing me his guitar.
Shame on you.
My grandson is a sweet little angelito querido cielito. He wants no part of your music, mariachi. You keep away from him.
So when did the idea for this first come about?
It was about 6 years ago when we finished making Toy Story 3. We started to think about what we wanted to be up to next. And so we kicked around a few different ideas. And one of the ideas that we had early on was the idea of telling a story set against the Mexican tradition of Dia de Muertos. And so we pitched that to the studio. It was a very different story than what we ended up with. But that concept was what we had at the beginning. And we got a thumbs up from the studio, and we promptly headed down to Mexico to start researching. And it was because of all the research we did and all the trips to Mexico that our story started to emerge based on the experiences that we had down in Mexico.
And I mean, obviously it's a very vibrant and very specific look. I mean, how did you kind of manage to graft a family adventure out of that? Because it's not natural that you'd meet the two things, I guess, when you think about the way everyone dresses up in the parties. It's got a dark look, but obviously it works fantastically well. So when did you come up with the idea that it could be a family adventure?
Well, I think we always knew it was going to be that. Mm-hmm. And we knew that we weren't making a film about death. It wasn't mm-hmm. going to be a dark, gloomy film. I mean, we always wanted it to be very bright and colorful and celebrate the music and the color right. and the feeling of Mexico.
Yeah, and when you're down in Mexico, anywhere, but in particular during the celebration of Dia de Muertos, it is full of so much color, so much music, food, a lot of celebration, and it's a very optimistic kind of time of connection.
Dante? Dante? Dante, wait up! You gotta stay with me, boy. We don't know where.
This isn't a dream, then. You're all really out there.
You thought we weren't?
Well, I don't know. I thought it might have been one of those made-up things that adults tell kids, like vitamins.
Miguel, vitamins are a real thing.
How did you go about putting the voice cast together?
It was a lot of fun. We definitely had restrictions on ourselves because we made a commitment early on that we would have an all-Latino cast. We didn't want to just stick random people of other cultures and backgrounds in the movie. We wanted to really celebrate the fact that this story takes place in Mexico. So there were some people that came together rather easily. We knew from pretty early on that we wanted to work with Gael Garcia Bernal. And so we pitched the movie to him, and he was very excited to be a part of it. And the same is true with Benjamin Bratt, who plays Ernesto de la Cruz. For a character like Miguel, that was actually a lot of work to find the right kid. I mean, we saw hundreds and hundreds of kids all over Mexico and the United States, and luckily we finally found our Miguel with Anthony Gonzalez.
What was it about him that stood out? Because obviously casting, you know, 12-year-old is right. you know, not an easy process.
No, not at all.
He is, well, when you meet him, which I'm sure someday you will, he's just an enormously engaging, charismatic, a young man, and he was doing our temporary voice for a while for putting up our reels, and he has the work ethic. He was the right age. He can sing, and he's just really talented, and it takes somebody with that kind of level of engagement and talent to carry a whole film.
Mm-hmm. He's in every scene of the whole movie, so it was almost more important to get his casting right than anyone else in the film. And it's hard. It's hard. It's like finding a needle in a haystack when you try to find a kid who can act and who's just right for a part. But thankfully, Anthony walked into our lives one day.
No crossing the bridge.
You know what? I'm just going to zip right over. You wouldn't even know I'm gone. Hey!
Almost there.
Just a little further.
Oopsie daisy.
Fine, okay. Fine, who cares? Come, Flower Bridge!
Aw, I don't know what I'd do if no one put up my photo.
Next?
Oh, Camilo, it's our turn.
Welcome back, amigos. Anything to declare?
As a matter of fact, yes.
Hola.
I mean, having worked on kind of big animation project before, I mean, you know how much work is involved in getting all the looks right. The skeletons in this in particular are fantastic and the way the bones are, but it's very bright and vibrant. How difficult was it to kind of, you know, make everything that seem friendly in what's... You know,
with the skeletons?
Yeah.
We always wanted them to be friendly and appealing, even though they're skeletons, because they're meant to be characters. They're meant to be real people that you get to know and like, and we didn't want them to be frightening at all. So we spent a lot of time early on finding ways to make them appealing in their design. We made a choice to give them eyeballs, which I think really helps keep them more friendly and makes them characters that hopefully the audience can really connect with emotionally and care about. But at the same time, we tried to really embrace what was fun about skeletons and what was fun about having them in an animated film with, you know, how they can be constantly falling apart and having to put themselves back together. And we kind of looked for every opportunity that we could to find ways to make them entertaining.
And you've had real success in the US with this already. I'm sure you'll have the same over here. Do you think there's a path for another story for Coco, or do you really see this as its own one-off?
Well, we really made it as a one-off story. When people ask us about sequels, we're happy because it just tells us that we succeeded in creating a world and characters that people want to see more of. So, I don't know, if the right idea came along, you never know. Never say never.
It's you, that boy from the land of the living. You're all anyone has been talking about.
What are you doing?
I'm walking like a skeleton.
Skeletons don't walk like that.
It's how you walk.
No, I don't.
It's almost sunrise.
Family.
You can do this.
Never forget how much your family loves you.